Hi, I'm John Murray. I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Genetics here at Penn. I want to talk to you today about something that I'm very excited about, which is some of the applications of modern imaging tools to study animal development. So just to sort of illustrate the problem that we're going to be talking about is a fundamental problem that's faced by all animals as they're developing. Of course, we're partial to humans, being humans ourselves. And that's how we go from this single cell, which is a pretty complicated cell, but it doesn't look that interesting. It's sort of a round thing with a couple nuclei in it, and the fertilized egg. And over the course of, in our case, 9 months or 18 years or perhaps our whole lifetime, we're still developing, we go to this huge organism now with trillions of cells, incredible diversity of different cell types. And all of this process is encoded by a relatively distinct set of regulatory genes and proteins, transcription factors being especially critical components, maybe a dozen or so signaling pathways. And these things all act in combination to allow the cells, as they divide and differentiate, to adopt the different fates during development. So just to give you an outline of what I'm going to tell you about, I'm going to start with sort of some of my thoughts about why we study and why we should teach developmental genomics in the classroom. I'm going to give a very brief high-level overview of some of the principles of development, processes of development, and how they interface with the genome and how the genome is controlling those. And then I'm going to talk about some of the model systems that we use to study development, which are much more amenable to experimentation than humans, where it's obviously very hard to do experimental studies. And I'm going to focus a little bit on some of the work that I'm most familiar with, looking at especially cool model organism, the nematode C. elegans. And then end with some future prospects. So why should we study and teach development? The first thing I would argue is this is an incredibly beautiful process. So it's a fantastic way to get students interested in biology. This is just now four different model organism systems looking at the process of development. We have a fruit fly undergoing gastrulation. We have a C. elegans embryo undergoing its whole embryonic development. That thing that in the bottom left corner there that just bumped is a frog embryo, and then the lower right one is actually a human embryo that just hatched out of its eggshell. We'll have examples of some of those. You can talk more in detail later on. So this is a great process visually, just to look at some of the fundamental processes in biology. And really, it's an extremely complicated process. The whole process is encoded in our genome sequences, which have really all the instructions. Obviously, our genome encodes much of our physiology, but development, I would argue, is probably the most complex process that our genome has to orchestrate. And so there's especially complicated and interesting mechanisms of regulation that occur during development. The other thing, I think, as a classroom tool that I would argue could make this process especially useful is that studies of development, you really have to integrate across many different methods and disciplines within biology. So I listed here genetics and genomics, which are tools that are primarily used to identify major regulators. And then once those regulators have been identified, you might go to biochemistry and molecular biology to work out the mechanisms by which those regulators orchestrate different decisions. The process itself involves really complicated cell biology, where cells are migrating and changing their shape. And so all of studying a single process, and you can really integrate a lot of these different toolkits within biology. So I want to focus especially here on regulation of gene expression. This slide just shows you a representation of a tiny part of an animal genome. In this case, part of the worm genome. And the little boxes there represent coding genes, the code for protein. And all that space in between them is DNA that's not encoding protein. And much of that DNA, that is its function is actually to regulate the expression when and where those different protein coding genes are turned on and off. And it turns out that this regulatory DNA is especially important in human health. So even though classically human genetics focused on the study of mutations that change protein sequences, but it turns out as we've got better tools to study common disease and the risk factors for common disease, many of those common disease risk factors actually lie not in the coding sequences, but in the regulatory sequences. And this map is just a representation of the entire human genome, where every one of those little tiny circles is a risk locus for some common disease or trait. And the vast majority of those lie actually not in the coding sequences, but in these regulatory sequences. Just to zoom into one example of these that is a semi-famous example from that was identified here at Penn, is, now again, this is a small chunk of the genome, and using some of these modern genome-wide association study approaches, Dr. Dan Rader and his colleagues here were able to identify this variation in the genome RS1274037-4, lovely name, that predisposes. So if you have the protective variant of this, it actually, or the deleterious variant of this, then it changes your cholesterol level, your risk of having different higher or lower levels of cholesterol, and this variant doesn't change coding sequence of any gene. It actually lies in between these two different genes and doesn't act on either of the genes that it's adjacent to, but actually acts to regulate the expression of this more distant gene, SORT1. This is just one example, but again, just to drive home, regulation of gene expression is most, I think it's most complicated in development. And this is a place where I think we have the hardest time experimentally if we find a variant that predisposes us, to some disease in a developmental regulation. We don't really understand those sequences very well. So this is one of the reasons that we're especially interested in studying development, is to try to work out the code for how those regulatory sequences work. And finally, I want to just pitch development. You hear a lot now about regenerative medicine. What is regenerative medicine? I would argue it's developmental biology fundamentally. We have, our bodies are made up of all these incredibly diverse cell types that perform extremely specific functions. They're all programmed, generated using the same genome. So in this example, we have some fibroblasts, we have endothelial cells which line your vasculature, we have some other blood cells, we have a neuron, and we have these extremely distinct forms. So what regenerative medicine fundamentally is in a patient that has some defect in one or more of these cell types, to take some starting cell, maybe you take a fibroblast that you can get from a cheek swab, reprogram it into some kind of stem cell state, and then differentiate it into the cell type that you want to be able to replace. Maybe you first do some genetic repairs in that cell to fix whatever the defect is that was causing the problem. So it's one example of where this is, I think, is especially promising, is in diabetes, where people have figured out now how to do exactly this process, starting from a fibroblast from the cheek. Using fundamental developmental biology tools, they figure out how to turn that into this iPS cell, which is a kind of stem cell, which is capable of giving rise to all the different cell types of the body. And then, again, using these fundamental signaling processes that have been worked out by studying the development of the pancreas, they're able to, in various steps, cause the cell to divide and differentiate into a beta cell, which is a cell in the pancreas that produces insulin, place that into, now the idea is that those cells could be protected in some way from the patient's immune system, transplanted into patients, and cause a patient with type 1 diabetes that then to be cured. And studies are ongoing to try and get this last step to get these patients actually functional into patients. All right. So now I'm going to switch gears and sort of give a very brief overview of some of the steps in animal development. I'm going to start with fertilization, then talk about sort of the cleavage, how we generate, go from one cell to many cells, and then gastrulation, morphogenesis, and differentiation, which are sort of the major sort of landmarks in development that establish the major body plan. All right, so this is step one of development. You have this giant haploid cell, the oocyte, now being attacked by swarms of sperm trying to be the one that gets in and fertilizes it. And this varies a little bit from species to species, but in terms of the length, but the first steps that occur after this process, so after the sperm gets into the egg, are controlled by factors that are already in that oocyte. Maternally provided factors. So actually, molecularly, the oocyte is one of the most complex cells not my body. I unfortunately don't have any oocytes myself. But these cells express an extremely complicated repertoire of genes that are going to allow, in our case, the first cell division or so of biology before to occur. And it's only later on in development, again, for us, for humans, it's fairly early, but in some invertebrate model organisms, there might be hundreds or even thousands of cells present before the zygotic nuclei actually start transcribing their own messenger RNAs. And up to that point, everything is controlled by this maternal contribution. The sperm provides almost nothing other than the DNA and perhaps a centrosome. So this is really all coming from the oocyte. So you have this incredibly complicated cell, and through this process of cleavage, these are reductive cell divisions, it goes from one cell now to many cells. So this is actually a human embryo that was imaged as in an in vitro fertilization clinic. You can see the cells dividing and now starting to compact, form this thing called a blastula, where you have basically a sphere of cells outside with an inner cell mass that's going to eventually give rise to the embryo. And there it is, hatching out of the eggshell. And now can be evaluated for its quality and implanted into a mother. So that process is called cleavage, and it basically gives rise to a large number of cells that have fairly similar. They're not that differentiated yet in terms of their cell fate. So the next sort of visibly obvious process, which is really hard to visualize in mammals. So this is actually a sea urchin embryo. This gastrulation, and this is the process that generates our actual body plan. So this sea urchin embryo, which was initially just a sphere, has started invaginating here. And some of the cells, you can see so there's basically the mesenchymal cells, which are sort of like mesodermal cells in the sea urchin. I can play this. Maybe I can't play this again. I'll go back. So we have this sort of this groove that's forming. And basically what this thing is going to bud off and actually form a tube that's going to become the endoderm, the guts of in this case, the sea urchin. A very similar process occurs, though, in vertebrates. And then there's cells in between, so the outer layer, the ectoderm, will give rise to the skin, the nervous system. This inner endoderm will give rise to the digestive system and various other things. And then the layers in between will give rise to the some of the skeletal tissue, muscle, things like that. And once you've formed that body plan, this is now a fish embryo. It's actually about to undergo gastrulation, although it's very hard to see in this movie, but the process I wanted to emphasize here is morphogenesis, where all of a sudden all these different cell types form and elaborate themselves into the different organs and body structures. So now you can actually sort of see superimposed on top of the yolk there, the head, the body, and the tail of the fish wrapped around the yolk there as it's developing. So how is all this happening at a molecular level? And that, to me, is the question that we're most interested in. We have this progression of cell states where you start with a zygote, which is totipotent. It can sort of by definition give rise to any of the cell types of the organism. and goes through a series of divisions to generate different progenitor cell states. And eventually, those progenitor cells, which are progressively specified into more restricted fates, give rise to the terminally differentiated muscle and skin and neuronal cell types, for example, that our body is comprised of. So a lot of times people like to invoke this classic diagram by Conrad Waddington, which sort of represents this process as the ball rolling down this hill with different decision points, where the fate of the cell, you know, as the ball rolls down the hill, it goes into progressively more restricted possible places where it could end up, which represent the terminally differentiated cells. All right, so what is this? So at the molecular level, the initial state, these sort of early totipotent or pluripotent cells that are present early in the embryo, we've learned a lot actually from studying embryonic stem cells in mice and also in humans about the factors that control this potency and allow those cells to maintain the potency and ability to differentiate into multiple different cell types. At the end of the process, we also understand a lot about these terminal selector genes, transcription factors and other genes that basically turn on the nuts and bolts of the cell types. So for example, the gene MyoD in a muscle cell will turn on, and some of its partners will turn on the various myosins and actins that are important to allow muscle cells to be contractile. But we don't understand nearly as well the processes sort of in the middle here, these intermediate progenitor cell states, which are controlled, we think, by largely signaling pathways and some called lineage-specific transcription factors that are expressed in some subset of the progenitor states. So how do we go about identifying these factors and studying them? So here's sort of our basic toolkit for developmental biology. Lineage tracing is sort of, before you even think about what are the genes that are involved, it's a process where you mark cells and follow cells across development and figure out starting at a blastocyst, what do the different cell types give rise to? We know the inner cell mass gives rise to the embryo, the exterior cells give rise to things like the placenta. At that stage in human development, for example. Classically, actually, lineage tracing in many model organisms was done by literally like marking specific cells with a dye. You could go in with like a little crayon, mark one cell red, and then look at the embryo later on in development or the adult animal and see where do that cell's descendants end up based on which ones inherited that dye. So using that, we've now quite a bit about the lineage maps and how the different progenitor states are propagated across development, especially in model organisms. It's much harder in mammalian systems and humans. So in model organisms, we can use tools like four genetic screens to, in an unbiased way, identify genes that are important for a process by looking for mutants that don't undergo that process normally, gas relation mutants, for example. Functional genomics methods, sort of a parallel approach, where we might use once we have a regulator, we can actually use these approaches to figure out where that regulator binds to the genome, figure out what its targets are, things like that. So an alternative to forward genetics is reverse genetics, and actually going in with specific candidate genes in mind, actually specifically occluding their function or depleting their function using methods like RNAi or now CRISPR, which is the hottest new method to delete genes from or modify genes in the genome. So that if you have a particular candidate in mind, that allows you to figure out its functional importance. And we're going to talk a lot about gene expression analysis, which is basically how you generate these candidates in the first place and methods to figure out when and where genes are expressed. And really, I think this is the place still where we have we're trying to generate the best handle on development, really just getting a descriptive picture of where different genes and regulators are expressed during development. And the hope is that over the next years to decades, that we'll be able to use these big maps that I'm going to tell you about to work out really in unprecedented scale and detail the mechanisms that different cell fate decisions are controlled. All right. So we'd love to understand how all of our cell types are generated, but it's really hard to study this in humans because one, we don't do experiments on humans. And two, human development is really complicated and not accessible to even really to visualization. You can't take a pregnant woman and put her on a microscope and take a movie of her embryo developing across, through the 9 months of gestation. Right, so this is where we tend to turn to model organisms. Right, so there's many classic, commonly used model organisms, including the worm, the fly, fish, frogs, sea urchin. I'll show you some pictures in the next slide. These have a lot of advantages. One of the key ones is besides the fact that obviously we can actually morally allow ourselves to do experiments on say a sea urchin or a worm. They develop much more quickly than humans, so you can actually do experiments in a feasible time scale. Many of these animals go from fertilization to a fully formed, organism with a recognizable body plan in a day or less of development. These organisms are, I didn't put mouse on here, because mouse is actually also a commonly used development organism, but the ones I listed here they all develop externally outside of the mother, and so you can take an embryo and actually literally watch it as it's developing. And they have, by and large, powerful tools, genetic or other experimental tools, that allows us to query gene function. Despite all these advantages, though, the fundamental mechanisms that control the formation of the body plan, the specification of different cell types, for example, and the genes that are actually controlling those processes are generally highly conserved. And so if you identify a gene, for example, in worm, that's important for the specification of muscle or mechanism that muscle regulator uses to turn on that muscle fate, there's a good chance that same mechanism is actually going to apply to humans, and we can use cell assays using human cells to try and test those kinds of ideas. So this is now just a few examples of some of what some of these model organisms look like. Probably the most well-studied at this point model organism for development is the fruit fly Drosophila, which has these beautiful patterns of segmental gene expression that occur across development. We'll talk a little bit more about those a little bit later. I'm personal favorite. My personal favorite is the roundworm C. elegans, because that's what we actually study in my own lab. Mouse is by far the most tractable and best studied mammalian model system, as opposed to our gestation, which is 9 months. The mouse, it's only barely over 2 weeks of gestation, so you can really in a relatively reasonable time frame to take a particular gene, for example, and study what's the expression pattern or the functional importance of deleting that gene in the mouse. And mouse being much more closely related to us than some of the other organisms, there's a big advantage to doing it there. The frog is another one of the really early classic experiments. One of the great advantages of the frog is you can actually, they learned a lot by cutting out bits and pieces of the frog embryos and pasting them into other frog embryos. And using that, they were able to identify parts of the embryo that signal into other parts of the embryo, for example, to induce the process of gastrulation that I showed you about. It's a more challenging system genetically because they're tetraploid, so it's much harder to, and they also have a very long reproductive life process, and so it's hard to do for genetic screens, but there's other tools available now to perturb gene function there. Zebrafish is another great system, and there's a lot of there's better genetics in zebrafish, but it has some similarities in its development to the frog. And then sea urchin and sea squirt, which are less, I think, not quite as widely used, but they both have their following. The sea urchin in particular has one of the best understood gene regulatory networks, the set of genes, different regulatory genes, and how they regulate each other and eventually give rise to the different cell fates. Has been really, really pioneered by Eric Davidson's work in the sea urchin. The sea squirt, these things in their adult state, they look almost like they could even not be animals. They're just little sessile things that stick to the pilings and appear in the ocean and things like that. They filter feed out algae and things from the ocean. But they're actually chordate. So they're more closely related to us than in any of the other non-vertebrate systems that are on the slide, and they go through this tadpole-like stage after embryogenesis and before they form these filter feeder structures that actually can swim around and has a notochord, which is sort of the fundamental feature of a chordate. They've been used, they have a really nice evolutionary niche that has been made them useful for understanding particular processes. And so I showed you this slide before. This is a Drosophila embryo undergoing gastrulation, and I really like this slide, this movie from a group at Genelia Farm, because it really emphasized, I think, the complexity of the developmental process. We start with this basically ovoid group of somewhat basically identical looking cells, and it turns itself inside out, and all the cells start migrating in different directions and changing in size and shape. We aren't seeing any of the differentiation events that are happening here in terms of the actual cell fates that are being specified. But you can really appreciate that this is an extremely complicated process. But it also emphasizes the fact that we've now gotten to the point with the imaging tools where we can actually follow all of these cells in live imaging. So we can, taking this movie, we can figure out at the last time point, where did each of those cells come from in the initial embryo. And we can learn a lot by that kind of lineage tracing approach about how different tissues are specified. All right. So these two sort of general strategies to identify the regulators of these processes that I want to go over. The classic approach, it would be using forward genetics. You do a screen, you mutagenize your flies or your fish or your worm, and look for mutants that have some kind of abnormal development. In the case of worm, maybe they're missing some cell that you think is an interesting cell, and you want to understand how it's specified. Once you've identified those genes, then you figure out where are those genes expressed. Try and work out, which of the cells and those genes are actually important in. And then from there, maybe go on to more detailed mechanistic studies, trying to figure out what the targets are. For example, if the gene is a transcription factor, or who the partners, which genes are working with which other genes for any given process. The alternative, which I think has a lot of promise, especially for some of the harder processes that have been less amenable to the forward genetics approach, is to combine genomics with reverse genetics. So here the strategy is reverse. We start by figuring out when and where candidate regulatory genes are expressed across the animal. And once we know those expression patterns, then we can start testing them systematically for a function. One of the big advantages of this is it can actually still work when you have genes that are redundant. So in a classic forward genetic screen, if you have two genes that are redundantly regulating the process you're interested in, if you mutate one or you mutate the other, you'll go see a phenotype. You really need to mutate both of them. And this genomics reverse genetics approach can really allow you to identify the candidates for genes that you actually would want to do, using more targeted methods like CRISPR. These make double mutants, in for example, into different genes. It's also sort of the flip side of this problem is pleiotropic genes. A lot of times you have one regulator that's important not just for your process, but maybe for 10 or 12 other processes that occur during development. Maybe the first process that it's important for is like the first cell division. And so the phenotype of your mutant is that the first cell never divides, the zygote never divides. And then it's really hard for you to tell that your gene also has some later role in the specification of skeletal tissue or something like that. And so, again, using this reverse genetics approach, you can figure out, well, this gene's expressed in lots of different times and places, and maybe try to perturb its activity just in the tissue that you care about. So we've learned now, I think, and I'll go through some of the methods we're using for this, a lot about the developmental dynamics of gene expression. Lots of different model organisms now have these efforts to generate atlases. So here, this is just a bunch of pictures of fly embryos, each one labeled by this in situ hybridization method for the expression of a different gene. You can see they're expressed in all manner of different stripes and bands and more complicated patterns here. Similar kind of work has been done in mouse, although not quite as large of a scale. The experiments are more cumbersome in mice. I'm going to show you a little bit at the end about the worm and the advantages the worm has for doing this kind of analysis. So if you have these kind of detailed expression pattern information, a lot of times actually you can make a fairly strong claim about function. So as this one example, so these embryos on the top with all these different colors, those are labeled, these are fly embryos, and the different colors are the expression domains of a bunch of different related genes called Hox genes. Basically, in flies, but also in humans, the position in the body plan is each position in the body plan has a distinct set of fates that it's supposed to undergo, and those are specified by these Hox genes. Right. And so, for example, this yellow gene, gene that is in yellow, which is called antennapedia, if that's misexpressed in the pink area, which normally doesn't express this antennapedia gene, it actually causes that region to develop the way its normal region was. And it turns out the place where antennapedia is normally expressed gives rise to legs in that segment of the fly. So if you express it in the head, what you get is a fly with legs growing out of its head. So this is just sort of a fairly especially dramatic example of how you can learn about the function of a gene by changing the expression pattern. Again, so sticking with the fly at a more basic level, the actual body plan of the fly is made up of these segments, which is a little bit different from how say many other organisms types of organisms develop. Again, we can learn about the specification of segmental patterns looking at these expression atlases. You can see these classic regulators of segment boundaries, even skipped, for example, on the top, are expressed in these stripe-like patterns that really delineate the boundaries of the different segments. So how are these things generated? So there's a lot of different ways we can study gene expression. As a genomicist, you know, we like to think about methods like microarrays or now RNA sequencing, where you take some piece of tissue, you do the genome-wide expression assays where you figure out the expression of all the genes in the genome in that particular sample. The analogous thing for proteins would be to do some mass spectrometry, where you can now identify many of the proteins expressed in a given sample. This is really sensitive. It's not so sensitive for mass spec. You need a fairly large amount of sample. But the RNA sequencing approaches have gotten very sensitive, and you get really genome-wide view of expression, but you have to cut out or somehow isolate the different stages and regions of the embryo that you're interested in to actually get any kind of spatial temporal resolution. So the alternative in terms of resolution is to do something like in situ hybridization to label RNA or antibody staining to look at protein. These methods, you can get really high resolution. You have single cell resolution or even subcellular resolution expression patterns for proteins or for RNAs. But you have to generate different reagents for every gene, so you have to do this one gene at a time. So it's much more challenging to do this at genome scale. People are doing it, and then a third approach is to use something like a transcriptional or translational reporter gene, where you actually modify the organism's genome, tag the gene you're interested in, for example, with green fluorescent protein, and now you have a system where you're not looking at the endogenous gene anymore. So you have some you have to do some work to figure out whether your reporter is actually faithfully recapitulating the endogenous gene's expression. But you can actually do live imaging of that. You can watch the, for example, green fluorescent protein as it comes and goes during development, especially in these model organisms with external development, where you can collect movies of those animals' development, look at fluorescence changes over time. And there are, this is at the end here, a few kinds of proteins where you can actually use dyes that directly bind to protein. So this is especially useful looking at specific tissues. For example, muscle you can label using phloidin, which binds to actin fibers, but it's really limited to particular fates and not so much to all the genes in the genome. So a couple of sort of favorite technologies here. This method was really, I think, popularized by Arjun Raj, again here at Penn, who wanted to develop a method to actually visualize RNA molecules in a cell. And the way this works is you make a bunch of probes. These are, so this black line, these black lines are the a messenger RNA molecule, and you make these probes that are antisensed, so complementary to the RNA molecule, short probes that are, each one of them is labeled with a fluorescent molecule. And by having this long, this tiled set of probes across the entire RNA, you can incubate these with cells and get a picture like this. Now here's a cell, the blue thing is the nucleus, and each of those white dots is one mRNA molecule for this particular gene that they studied. Okay, so these are cells, but you can actually do this in developing organisms. So these are now C. elegans embryos, looking at the expression of four different genes in different colors here. These are genes that are important for the specification of the intestine of the worm. And you can actually literally go into each of these embryos and count how many molecules of mRNA there are and look at the differences in position within the embryo as well. So that's great, but you can't do this in live animals. You have to fix the embryos with formaldehyde first. So to get a live readout of gene expression, the most common approach is to use reporter genes. The way this works, you have some gene. So in this case, this gene we studied, say 36, which is a worm transcription factor. And you can either replace the gene with, say, mCherry, it's a red fluorescent protein, or you can leave the gene there and add, in addition to that, fuse to the protein, a green fluorescent protein. And so these two different approaches, we call these transcriptional reporter, which uses the top one with the mCherry, gives you some readout of where the sequences that you've attached to the red fluorescent protein drive expression, but it doesn't tell you about the dynamics of the actual protein. Whereas the one at the bottom, where you've actually tagged the protein with GFP, you can actually see when that thing is localized to nucleus, when it's degraded, and you get much more complicated picture of its regulation. We'd like to be able to make those kinds of reporters, again, for all the regulatory genes in the genome. This is where some of the model organisms are big advantages, have big advantages relative to others. So in a system like mouse, one, it's hard to do the live imaging in the first place, but two, it's really expensive and cumbersome to make reporter strains, and each one may cost you thousands of dollars to make a stable transgenic line. Whereas in organisms like worm or fly, or especially in fish, you can actually do this much cheaper and higher throughput. So we've been involved in a project to try to label most of the transcription factors of the worm. The worm makes about 1,000 transcription factors, and I think we're on progress. So we should be able to, in the next few years, to have green fluorescent protein labeled versions of all the transcription factors of the worm. Doing the whole genome, I think, will be more challenging. But these costs keep going down with new technology, and so hopefully with things like CRISPR, which is the latest technology for genome editing, we should be able to get these costs even lower. Right, so these are, so yeah, so again, I mentioned this before, but there's been a concerted effort in many model organism communities to generate these large-scale gene expression maps that can be used for some of these mechanistic studies more downstream that I referred to in the beginning. I think the best examples are in fly and in worm. There's also efforts in mouse, especially in the brain. They use all these different methods. Some of them use in situ hybridization. Some of them have focused more on reporters, for example. One of the big challenges in these efforts, you have now, for example, in the Drosophila embryo, we have, using in situ hybridization, expression patterns for thousands of genes. This has been done using this RNA in situ hybridization kind of approach, and you get these patterns. This is just an example of the gene giant at two different stages, stage 6 and stage 10. You can see it has very different expression patterns at different stages, and then a different gene at stage 10 in GRAIL, which has now yet a third expression pattern. So if I gave you these three pictures and asked you which of these genes is co-expressed and in which tissues, it would be very hard, even for an expert, to make that call. There's small differences in the morphology of these animals. Even within, for example, in the expression pattern for giant at stage 10, you can see these blobs of expression, but there could be cells that are expressing giant mixed with other cells that are not expressing that gene within those blobs. It's really hard to make that out. So people have gone to higher resolution approaches for imaging, which has helped with that some, and had developed various methods now, and this is where the technology has really been impressive, I think, over the last 5 to 10 years to see how it's improved, to computationally take images like these and map them onto each other, so you get sort of getting close to single cell resolution at which genes are co-expressed. So one of these approaches, for example, in Drosophila, you can take advantage of this segmentation process. So you have genes, in this case they're labeled in red, that are expressed in the boundaries of different segments, and you can label those genes with one color and then label some other gene that you're interested in with a different color, and you can use those segment boundaries basically as landmarks to align the different embryos that you've imaged together. And using that, you can actually get a much better reconstruction of which genes are co-expressed. So a number of groups are using this technology in Drosophila to ask all sorts of interesting questions about the mechanisms that control the robustness of cell fate specification, for example, and the activity of different enhancers, the gene sequences that are the extragenic sequences that control when these genes are expressed during development. Another one of my favorite atlases is the so-called Allen Brain Atlas. This was originally generated in the mouse, now they've literally sliced up mouse brains and use this in situ hybridization approach to define the spatial expression patterns of all of the genes, pretty much, in the mouse, and the smaller number in human brains that were donated to research. So the same alignment problem that applies again, sort of similar kind of tools have been developed to try to take these different brains that have been labeled for different genes and align them to try and get a sense of which genes are expressed in which cells. And so using this now, you can make some pretty strong hypotheses about genes that might be involved in specifying different subtypes of neurons in the brain and how those neurons might be connecting to each other. And so groups like these and this new NIH Brain Project that President Obama announced fairly recently are targeting now, trying to understand actually how the wiring of the brain is specified, which will complement this kind of approach. All right. So just for the last few minutes, I want to tell you about my favorite model system, C. elegans, this nematode worm. I think is really an ideal system for a study of many developmental questions. This is just a worm crawling around on its favorite home in the lab, which is a petri dish. It crawls around on the dish, it eats E. coli, so it's super easy to grow. It only takes 3 days to grow from a fertilized egg up to an adult worm that's laying its own eggs, so it's a very efficient experimental system. In the wild, these things live primarily in rotting fruits. They love to eat the kind of bacteria that you can find in that kind of sort of rich organic environment. Compost heaps is another good place to find these worms in the wild. So I showed you before a human embryo and Ben Franklin. Now this is the C. elegans version of that problem. You have a fertilized egg here on the left and an adult worm on the right. It's much smaller than us, right? So remember, we have, roughly speaking, 10 to the 14th cells. This adult worm has 959 cells. So we can actually go through and count them one at a time, and there's exactly 959 in every animal. At the end of embryogenesis, there's 558, so it's even smaller. The genome is much smaller than our genome, so it's easier to look for. There's a much smaller space in which to look for regulatory sequences. And like I said, it develops very rapidly. So here's just a C. elegans embryo dividing. It doesn't have quite as dramatic a cell movements as you could see, for example, in the Drosophila fruit fly embryo movie that I showed you earlier. But it's so small, you can actually follow each of these cells literally. And people did this now over 30 years ago. John Sulston, who won the Nobel Prize for that work, worked out the entire cell lineage of the embryo. Sort of one of the, perhaps because the worm is so small, it's very robust in how it develops. So every time you look at a different worm embryo, it undergoes exactly the same pattern of cell divisions and generates exactly that same set of 558 cells at the end of embryogenesis. And this tree at the bottom is the family tree of those cells. So that tells you in one embryo, how are all the cells that were produced in that embryo related to each other, starting from the zygote at the top and following time down to the hatch. At the bottom there. And you get the same tree if you do this for any C. elegans embryo. And not only is the pattern of cell divisions invariant, but the pattern of fate specification is also invariant. So different parts of the lineage give rise in every embryo to the same tissue. For example, the cell in, sort of in the middle that I've labeled orange, called E, it's always the sister of a cell called MS, and it always gives rise to the intestine of the worm. So every one of those cells has a programmed fate that we can predict based on its lineage history. So it's possible now to automate the tracking of the cell lineage process. The image I showed you before, if it's following different cells, you actually have to go through and click on the cell one time point at a time, and it's a very laborious process. But using a movie like this one, where all of the nuclei are labeled with a green fluorescent protein tagged histone, you can actually train a computer program to track the cells across time and follow, you know, identify each time point, track them across time, figure out which cells give rise, you know, which cells are dividing and what their daughters are. And maybe you have some other gene that you've labeled in a second color that you can look at its expression in that same embryo. And so that computer program will basically convert that image movie, the three-dimensional movie, into a lineage tree like this, where now you have the entire embryo lineage of that particular embryo with the gene's expression superimposed on it in this funny color scale, where purple is no expression and red would be the highest levels of expression. So this particular gene happens to be a conserved transcription factor that's important for digestive system or gut development. So this is critical, the human version of this is critical for the development of our gut, liver, intestine, so pancreas, and so on. And the worm gene is also involved in the development of its digestive system. Right, so we get these and this picture of gene expression for any given gene, that's single cell resolution. So that's really, I think, the highest level of resolution you can compare gene expression patterns at. You can do this also, it turns out, in post-embryonic stages as well, because they again have the exactly the same organization pattern of different cells in any given animal. So you can go through an image of a larval worm or adult worm and figure out what all the cells are and make these maps of gene expression across all the different genes that you look at. And because the lineage is invariant, we can look at a bunch of different genes in different embryos. In this case, we've looked at these four different genes. These are all conserved transcription factors that are involved in specification of different fates. In this case, MyoD is involved in muscle, GATA is involved in intestine, FOXA is involved in the broader digestive system, NeuroD is involved in different neurons, and we can actually map those gene expression patterns onto each other, figure out which cells, in a single cell resolution, co-express each of, you know, different combinations of the different genes we've looked at. So we've done this not just for these four genes, but now for hundreds of different transcription factors that are expressed during development. You know, and you can learn a lot just by looking at these patterns, and without going into, you know, too many of the details, you can see genes, like these are examples of genes expressed in different tissue-specific expression patterns. You can find genes that might be regulating neurons or gut or skin development, for example. Other genes are expressed not in specific tissues, but in specific positions, just the anterior, the future head of the worm, just the posterior, the future tail of the worm, or different intermediate positions. And we can find other genes that have maybe more interesting, complicated relationships in terms of the lineage history of the cells that express those genes. A lot of our work now is trying to understand how the lineage history in this particular organism gives rise to unique combinations of transcription factors that then ultimately turn on the cell fate. So ultimately, I think we're making a lot of progress in a long way there now to understand, at least in the simple model system, what are the transitions in the molecular identity of the cells as you go from the zygote up to these terminally differentiated cells, sort of fuzzy middle steps of development that we haven't really understood so well previously, right? So we're doing this in worms. I think one of the things that's revolutionizing, and I think will probably revolutionize not just worm development, but all of these model systems development is single cell genomics. And so just in the last few years, it's really become, I think, broadly possible for many different groups to take single cells from tissues at a large scale and using methods like RNA sequencing, before that microarrays, so many of these methods were actually pioneered here at Penn as well. You can figure out genome-wide what are the genes expressed in a single cell. So, for example, in this now classic study, sort of funny to think of a classic study being from 2014, developing lung tissue from mouse was used to try and work out what are the relationships between progenitor cells and the different differentiated cells that are found in the developing lung. And the lung is nice because it develops in an asynchronous way. So within the same bit of tissue, you can have both naive progenitor cells and terminally differentiated different cell types of the lung. And using this, they were able to identify, you know, not just the gene expression profiles of these terminally differentiated cell types, you know, cells involved in producing surfactant or in gas exchange, for example, but the relationship of those to the progenitor cells. And it's now possible with some of the most recent methods to do this kind of single cell genomics on, you know, a scale of tens or even hundreds of thousands of cells. So I think we're at the point now where it's possible to imagine experiments to work out across all of the cells of an organism's development how all the genes change, at different stages during development, and really to work out the full complexity of the gene expression changes in development. Right. So that's great. We have developed these atlases, and I think we're the prospect for even more comprehensive gene expression profiles is great. But really, these are just the starting point for more mechanistic studies. And our group and others have been, I think really just in the last few years started to use these big atlases as starting points for understanding critical questions in development. And I'm not going to go through any of those in detail today, but I think some of the really interesting questions have to do with what is the grammar or logic in the DNA sequences that control expression. If you take a sort of by analogy to the genetic code, if you look at a piece of sequence that codes for protein, we can say, well, this is going to encode this protein. We can figure out a sequence using the genetic code. We can't do the same thing right now for a regulatory sequence. If you look at that sequence, we can make some predictions about what transcription factors might bind to it, but we really can't work out what expression pattern that sequence will control. And I think that is sort of the holy grail right now of developmental gene expression studies, is trying to work out what is the logic controlling those gene expression decisions. How is the timing of developmental events coordinated? You see a lot of times a group of cells will make specific decisions, and then they'll go through independently huge amounts of developmental time. In the case of humans, this might be weeks or months, and then synchronously all together they'll all make some coordinated decision to generate some particular organ, for example. So how are those cells communicating with each other, making sure that they undergo these developmental events at exactly the right time? And something that I think some of these atlases are providing clues about some of the regulators that might be important timekeeper mechanisms. How does this process stay so robust? There's a huge amount of environmental variability. Now, many of the model organisms, they grow in places like compost heaps, where you can imagine just crazy variations in temperature. But even in humans, like things like diet, for example, or drug exposure, can be fairly dramatically different from embryo or fetus to one to another. And yet, we have this fairly robust development. And finally, how is context specificity controlled? So one of the general features of these regulatory networks that have been started to be worked out that control these different developmental decisions is that you see the same regulator. I showed one example of this, this giant gene in Drosophila. They'll be maybe expressed and active at one stage in development in one set of cells, and then later it'll be expressed and active in a totally different set of cells, often regulating a totally different set of targets. How is that context specificity controlled? We have a lot of hand-wavy explanations, but we don't really have a strong mechanistic insight. So that's another, I think, big question. Right. So just before I close, I wanted to put in one last plug for development as a great system in the classroom, and there's great resources out there. So I just wanted to plug, in particular, the Society for Developmental Biology has this great website. That has lots of education resources and things like class plans and things like that that are, I think, a great resource for thinking about looking at development in the classroom. Here's a couple of worm-specific examples as well of people who have developed both labs and other lesson plans based around the worm. Thanks.